do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? We do. But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? We do. Do you wish that you could see it all made new? We do. Is all creation groaning?
It
is a new creation coming?
It
is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The light of Judah, who conquered the grave, is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is it worthy, is it worthy of a blessing and honor and glory? Is it worthy of it?
It is.
Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those He loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, David's ruler, the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, He has made us a kingdom and priests to God to reign with the Son. Is He worthy? Is He worthy? Is He worthy? Is He worthy? Is He worthy of this? He is. Is He worthy? Is He worthy?
And the tempter moves. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our combined joint New Year's Eve service. We're so glad that you could be with us tonight. It's a pleasure and a joy to be able to worship with you. I know last week our church was blessed being here with you all, and tonight I'm sure the same. If you don't know me, my name is Gareth. I'm the senior pastor of New Life Church. And tonight we want to give thanks to the Lord for His grace towards us over the last year. Even though this has been a very tough year, maybe for some the toughest year yet, but we know that God's grace is sufficient. He has provided sufficient grace for us each day of 2020, and He promises to do so in 2021. And every year of our lives, beyond that, until He returns or calls us home, and we look forward to that. So we have many things to be thankful for. And tonight, we want to encourage each other to look towards Christ, the very Son of God who became flesh and dwelt among us. And his light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. So let me open up our service with a word of prayer, and then Pedro will lead us in responsive reading from Psalm 136, and then after that we will sing together. Let's pray. Father, 2020 has been an extraordinary year. It's been extraordinarily difficult for some, extraordinarily sad, extraordinarily disappointing. But tonight, Lord, we look to you for comfort and hope as we anticipate what 2021 may hold. Lord, it would be a mistake for us to look anywhere other than you for our joy and peace. And we may be tempted tonight to think that a change in our circumstances will make us happier or safer or more satisfied. So please, Lord, help us not to look to the world or the flesh for what only you can provide us. Whatever this year holds, Lord, may we find our hope and our rest in Christ alone. So, Father, we praise you tonight that you are faithful to all of your promises. We praise you that you have the power to ensure that not a word of your promises ever falls to the ground, and our confidence is in you tonight, Lord. We praise you that even when men seek in the evil to obstruct your plans, you use the evil to bring your plans to fulfillment. And, Father, we praise you that you make your promises to those who do not even deserve them. So, Lord, we ask that you would bless our time together tonight. Bless everybody that's even logging on to watch the service tonight. We pray, Lord, that they will be filled with hope and with much joy tonight as we look forward to your grace again in 2021. So, Lord, we love you and we pray that you would help us to love you more tonight. May the Spirit speak to us. May the Spirit lead us. May the Spirit guide us and even comfort those who need to be comforted tonight with hope that is eternal, hope that is genuine and real. So, Lord, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. And tonight we ask that he would be exalted in all that we say and all that we do. And we pray this prayer in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good evening once again, church. As we open up our Bibles in Psalm 136 for our responsive reading, I'll invite the church to stand as we do so. It will be a chorus that all of us will be, as a congregation, will be responding. And as we do so, maybe I'll challenge you to count your blessings for this year. I'll start, and the congregation will just reply back for his steadfast love endures forever. Thus says the word of God. Give thanks to the Lord for he is good. Give thanks to the God of gods. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. To him who alone does great wonders. To him who by understanding made the heavens. To him who spread out the earth above the waters. To him who made the great lights, the sun to rule over the day, the moon and the stars to rule over the night, to him who struck down the firstborn of Egypt and brought Israel out from among them, with a strong hand and an outstretched arm. To him who divided the Red Sea in two and made Israel pass through the midst of it. but overthrew Pharaoh and his host in the Red Sea. To him who led his people through the wilderness, to him who struck down great kings and killed mighty kings, Sihon, king of the Amorites, and Og, king of Bashan, and gave their land as an heritage, an heritage to Israel, his servant. It is he who remembered us in our low estate and rescued us from our foes. He who gives food to all flesh. Give thanks to the God of heaven. Praise the Lord.
Good evening, church. Let us sing this song. This is Amazing Grace.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King of all kings, who shakes the whole earth with call and thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King of all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
This hymn was written after traumatic events in Horatio Spafford, the author's life. The first two were the death of his four-year-old son and the Great Chicago Fire of 1871, which ruined him financially. He had been a successful lawyer and had invested significantly in property in the area of Chicago that was extensively damaged by the Great Fire. His business interests were further hit by the economic downturn of 1873, at which time he had planned to travel to England with his family to help upcoming evangelistic campaigns. In a late change of plan, he sent the family ahead while he was delayed on business concerning problems following the Great Chicago Fire. While crossing the Atlantic Ocean, the ship sank rapidly after a collision with a sea vessel, and all four of Spafford's daughters died. His wife Anna survived and sent him the now famous telegram, "Safe alone." Shortly afterward, as Spafford traveled to meet his grieving wife, he was inspired to write these words as his ship passed near where his daughters had died. Brothers and sisters, whatever happens in our life, sufferings, sorrows, trials, pains, and tears, let us find the assurance in Jesus Christ our Lord, so that we can say, "It is well with my soul."
When peace like a river ascended my way, when sorrows like sea billows roar, there are ever my Lord, thou hast taught me to say, "It is well, it is."
It is well.
It is well.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome, and such a joy to be here with you this evening. We're going to keep delving into the Word this evening. We're going to look at the book of Exodus, chapter 34, and it's verses 1 to 8. I can take my mask off, my wife says. That's great. Let's go to the Word. The Lord said to Moses, "Cut for yourself two tablets of stone like the first, and I will write on the tablets the words that were on the first tablets, which you broke. Be ready by the morning, and come up in the morning to Mount Sinai, and present yourself there to me on the top of the mountain. No one shall come up with you, and let no one be seen throughout all the mountain. Let no flocks or herds graze opposite that mountain." So Moses cut two tablets of stone like the first, and he rose early in the morning and went up on Mount Sinai, as the Lord had commanded him, and took in his hand two tablets of stone. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. And Moses quickly bowed his head toward the earth and worshipped. Here is the word of the Lord.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Robert. I'm one of the elders at New Life, and I'll be leading us in the prayer of confession tonight. But I'd just like to remind us of Daniel's prayer of confession, where he prays in chapter 9. He says, "O Lord, the great and awesome God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments, we have sinned and done wrong and acted wickedly and rebelled, turned aside from your commandments and rules. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. To you, O Lord, belongs righteousness, but to us open shame." He continues and says, "To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him, and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord, our God, by walking in his laws, which he set before us by his servants, the prophets." So let us go to the Lord in prayer and confess our sins so that as Oswald Chambers said, leave the broken, irreversible past in his hands and step out into the invincible future with him. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the mighty name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. All glory and honor belong to you. We acknowledge you as the one and only true living God. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, who was, who is, and who is to come. You are the creator of the universe. You created us in your own image. We are owned by you, we are accountable to you, and completely dependent on you. You are the author of our salvation. Father, we pray that you have mercy on us as we confess our sins to you. We confess the things that we have done in thought, word, and deed, and for the things that we have left undone. Father, please forgive us when we have not loved you with all our hearts, with all our strength, and with all our minds. Also, when we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves, when we behaved in a selfish manner and have not considered the pain and the suffering of others, when we passed by those who were hungry, poor, or oppressed, for the times when we judged our neighbor in order to condemn them instead of lovingly correcting them. Father, please forgive us for the times when we did not trust or obey you, when we relied on ourselves and our own efforts, for the times when you called us and we completely ignored you. Father, please forgive us when we are disobedient to your church, your laws, and your will for our lives, for the times we have spent away from you, for not reading or meditating on your word, for not praying to you or spending time with you, for the times when we are attracted to the temporary pleasures of this world as opposed to your eternal kingdom. Father, please forgive us for the times when we have not spread your gospel to those who are lost and dying in their sin, when we were shy or worried about the consequences. Your Son Jesus reminds us in the word, whoever denies me before men, I will deny before my Father in heaven. Father, we acknowledge that we have fallen short of your standards. We are guilty, we are filthy and helpless in our sin. We deserve to stand under your wrath. But Father, we hold on to your promises when John writes in your word, if we confess our sins, that he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And Father, we know that this is only possible because of what your Son Jesus accomplished here on earth. He was born incarnate, fully human, fully divine, lived the perfect life, and died the most horrific death so that we could be reconciled and justified to you. Father, we praise you and honor you for the work of your Son Jesus, for without it we would be dead in our sin and condemned to death. So we pray that as we enter 2021, we submit our lives to you, and that we be guided by your Holy Spirit, our Comforter, our Counselor, our Encourager. Your Spirit brings order and peace to our chaotic lives. May your Spirit shed light on your word and guide us to be the salt and the light to this world. Father, we thank you, we praise you, we honor you, and we ask this all in your Son's precious and holy name, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Stand up. Revelation 5, verse 8 to 10 says, and when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals. For you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth.
Do you feel the world is broken
within you?
Do you feel the shadows deepen
with you?
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Is he worthy? Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus our Messiah hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, is taken through, and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign in the sun. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? He is.
Once again, good evening. I didn't introduce myself earlier. My name is David. I'm from New Life Church. And tonight, I just wanted to share something with you in regards to the Lord and how great He is. Sometimes as we look to the future, we need to look at the past. And I'd like to share a little bit of my past with you this evening and glorify God through that. Recently, we did a devotion on Psalm 116. And through that devotion in New Life Church, we challenged ourselves to define why we love the Lord. And when I went through that process, I looked back and had to think about why I did love the Lord. And through that process, I thought about my past. So I'm an identical twin. I'm from Australia. I had a mother who was not a Christian until we were about 3 or 4 years old. And a father who's not a Christian, still does not know the Lord to this day. But I was very blessed as a child to have a mother that knew the Lord and is a very, very strong servant of the Lord. She's an amazing woman through God's glory. And she showed us the gospel by taking us to church. She planted the seeds by supporting us through our childhood. And by about the time I was 14, I rejected church. I rejected the Lord. I rejected the whole thought of it. And I started going towards the world. Through that time, I delved deeper and deeper into the world. And when I was 18, I moved out from home. And I started embracing that very sick world that is all around us. And that included a lot of drugs. That was playing in bands and really taking whatever I could. And I sank down very, very deep. And through that process, I have to tell you that the Lord never let me go. Through that process, even when I was in the depths of my drug addiction, He'd always be on my shoulder. He was always saying, "David, you shouldn't be here." He never, ever let me go. Through that process, I met my beautiful wife, Dina, and I even had the gall to say to Dina, "Listen, I'm in the middle of this, what I want to do. I'm embracing what I want to do. It's all about me. But one day I will go back to God and to the church. And if we're going to start going out and having a relationship, then you need to also go to church with me when I'm ready." Now, what an arrogant statement that is, folks. Can you just hear that, the control that I think I have over my life? I was extremely, extremely blessed to have Dina in my life, and she knew of the Lord, and she agreed. We were both badly living in sin, but she agreed. And through that relationship, He's given me my best human friend. And through the grace of God, we got to a point where I hit rock bottom, and I was stealing money, and I was taking rent money from my wife and my children. My wife and children were bags packed and ready to go. They were ready to have a break from me. And I hit rock bottom. And at that time, as a lot of us do, when we hit rock bottom, we look up for the first time. And I'm just so blessed that the Lord kept me safe and protected through that process till I could look up. And then He dragged me out of that muck. It's been a long process with still a lot more honing to go with the potter's hand and with His grace. I will be more righteous. I know I'll never get there, but I know that the journey that I'm on is that path of being more like Christ. And I just thank Him so much for this path that we're on. The message I really want to say to you all is, as we move into 2021, I know that this has been a tough year for a lot of people. But don't give up hope. Don't give up hope, folks. If He has got you in His hands, He has got you in His hands. He will never let you go. He loves his children. Keep your eye on the eternity. Keep your eye on the prize that he is going to give us when we get to heaven with him. What a joyous day that will be. So when we move through to 2021, I urge you, go through that process. I love the Lord because he dragged me out of that mess. I love the Lord because he never let me go, and not once. I love the Lord because he gave me brothers and sisters that keep me accountable, that love me. I love the Lord because he's given me a wife and a family and a mother who is supportive. And I love the Lord because he chose me. I didn't choose him. He chose me. And I'm just so, so grateful that I'm one of his chosen. Folks, we'd like to continue this evening. Thank you for your singing. That was just absolutely amazing. What a joy it was to hear a congregation sing. Thank you for that blessing. And with that, we'll introduce our pastor for this evening. Thank you, folks.
Well, every week I watch Kurt and Aubrey struggle with this thing and their mask, and now I know. Now I know. Well, my name is Cass O'Rear. I'm one of the elders from ECC. It's my pleasure to proclaim God's word to you tonight, New Life Church and ECC, and the potentially millions watching online right now. So tonight we're going to be looking at the chapter in the Bible that says that December 31st, the New Year's Eve of the Gregorian calendar, is a special day. So turn your Bibles to that chapter. I'm joking. There's not a chapter in the Bible that says that New Year's Eve is a special day. It's not a special day. It's just another day. Praying at midnight tonight doesn't give you like super-powered prayers. Your prayers are powerful all the time. It's just another day. It's just another day. It's not special. Any more special than it always is. And, I want to start tonight by sharing something with you that is special. Years and years ago, I started asking a question in every small group I was a part of, and every Bible study I was a part of. And I still, to this day, ask it every single week. Even though the people in my small group are the same week in, week out, they can expect me to ask this question every time. And I'm going to ask it to you tonight, and I'm going to answer the question tonight. So what is the gospel? What is the gospel? That is the question for us as Christians to answer. And sadly, I've learned throughout the years that Christians, or those that proclaim to be Christians, often struggle to answer that question. So tonight, I want to help answer that question, and I want to give you a framework for how you can answer that question. And I'm stealing the framework from a guy named Greg Gilbert that wrote a book called, it's called What is the Gospel? I really recommend that you check that book out. So the framework that I would follow Greg's lead in establishing, and he's probably not the first person to ever say this, is God, man, Christ response. God, man, Christ response. When you ask what is the gospel, you start with God. And we say, there is a God. There's a God that's perfect, that's righteous, that's worthy of all worship and all praise. God created everything, the heavens and the earth. We look at Psalm 19:1, it says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. He made everything perfect. Perfect. This is God. He made man. He made man perfect. Adam and Eve, they were not sinful. They were made perfect. But what happened? They fell. They sinned. The world was fractured. The world was broken because of the fall of Adam in the garden. When sin entered the world, every single one of us died. We are born sinners. Ephesians 2 tells us that we are dead in our trespasses and sins. Every single one of us rebels against that God. That God that's worthy of our praise and worship. We turn our back on him. We don't worship him. We don't love him. And the really bad news is that there's nothing that we can do ourselves to change that. If given the choice, every single time we would choose sin over God, because we're that weak, because we're that broken. And God, being just and righteous, cannot tolerate sin. He must punish sin. And so, we are under the condemnation of God for our sin against him. We will be damned because of our sin. So that's man. It's God, man. The third is Christ. And that's where we get to the gospel. Gospel means good news. And this isn't just a simple good news. This is the greatest news there's ever been. The greatest news that's ever entered the world is that God, in spite of our rebellion against him, loved us and showed mercy to us. God sent his son, Jesus, to this world, fully God, fully man. He lived a perfect, righteous, sinless life. And people hear that and they say, if he didn't sin, then how could he truly be human? No, he's the true human. Just as we were meant to not sin, he did not sin. We're the broken ones. Our sin is what taints humanity. His sinlessness made him the ultimate human. The punishment for sin is death, both physically and spiritually, separated from God. And Jesus, living a perfect life, having never sinned, well, he wasn't due that punishment. He did not deserve to die. And yet, Jesus went to the cross. He went to the cross willingly, and he died on the cross. He died on the cross not for sins that he had committed, because he'd never sinned. He died on the cross for sins that we have committed. Those that placed their faith in Jesus, he died for our sins. He took on the full wrath of God for our sins, and he satisfied that wrath. He actually died. You might hear that and think, oh, I mean, he died? How is that good news? It's not so good for him. The greatest part is that he didn't just stay dead, that he rose. 3 days later, he conquered the grave. He defeated death. He overcame sin. That he is alive today. That he is ascended. And that he will return. So that's Christ. It's God, man, Christ. And the last one is response. Response. So the gospel demands a response. You don't just get to be saved. The whole world isn't saved. Salvation comes through placing your faith in Jesus Christ. Salvation comes by believing that He was Messiah, Savior. That He was the Christ. That He died for our sins. And not just believing that, but repenting of our sins. Turning away from our sins and turning to God. Completely changing our lives. The great news of the gospel is that God saves sinners through His Son, Jesus Christ. That we can be reconciled to God thanks to the work accomplished on the cross by His Son, Jesus Christ. So that's special. That's special. That is the greatest news anyone can ever share. That we can be reconciled to God. There is a way to be saved. That's special. Okay, so I said December 31st, New Year's Eve, the Gregorian calendar is not a special day. But, I was being a little cheeky, we do celebrate on this day, right? That celebration comes from us, though. It's a man-made holiday. But being that it's December 31st, it is a good time to step back and reflect on this past year. So let's do that now. We're sitting. Just take a moment and think about 2020. Think about everything that you went through in the past year. Think about what we collectively as a planet have gone through in the last year. Whew. It's been a hard year. The pandemic, I mean, that immediately springs to mind. That's affected everyone in some pretty huge ways. Whether you were, you know, inconvenienced by the fact that movie theaters are closed, or by the fact that you were stuck in an apartment with your family for a number of months in quarantine, or if something more serious happened to you, like you lost your job because of the pandemic. Someone you know died of COVID-19. It's been a hard year. I think most of us can say that we have experienced trials, that we've been tested. Well, our goal tonight is to leave with a biblical perspective of trials in the Christian life. So I was joking a little early about the chapter that we were going to read, but our text tonight is in Romans 8. So if you want to turn to Romans 8, that's where we'll be for the rest of the evening. And it's not lost on me that in God's sovereign providence that Pastor Gareth preached from Romans 8 last week as well. That was not planned. God apparently wants ECC and New Life to hear from Romans 8. Thankfully, I'm preaching from a different section, largely in Romans 8, but it's also in Romans 8. So let me read. We're going to be reading verses 35 through 39. If I can find it. Here we go. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. There's three things I think that we can take away from that. Three things that can give us a biblical perspective for trials. The first is that you're going to experience trials. You know, the prosperity gospel is, it's just everywhere now. It's far and wide. And they tell you that you're going to be healthy, you're going to be wealthy. If you name it, you can claim it. An end to suffering. And it's just not true. It's just a lie. It's so contrary to what the Bible actually tells us. You're going to face trials as a Christian. It says right there in the quotation from Psalm 44:22, it's verse 36. It says, "For your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered." Paul's writing to the Romans and telling us they can be literally killed. That's some extreme suffering. You can be killed. So tradition tells us that the apostles themselves, almost every single one of them was martyred and died a gruesome death. Paul himself was stoned and thrown in jail, and he was eventually killed. So one takeaway I have for you is that as Christians, you can suffer. Not just you can, you will suffer. You will experience trials. Absolutely. Absolutely you will. And you know why you will? Because of sin. Because this world is broken. Because of the fracturing of this world, until sin is removed, there will be suffering. There will be suffering. The second thing I think that we can pull out is that God uses trials for good. God is not guilty of sinning. God doesn't cause people to hurt. God doesn't cause pandemics. But he uses them. He allows things to happen and then he uses them. He uses them for the good of those who place their faith in him, and he uses them for his glory. You know, when we look back at the Old Testament, we see all sorts of stories. In almost every single one, we see that someone's going through a hard time. But something else that we see is that in every one of those instances, God is using those. I'm going to use Joseph as the main example for this. If you go back to Genesis and read the story of Joseph, you see that he was in slavery at one point. He was falsely accused. He was imprisoned. I mean, his own brothers sold him into slavery. That's a pretty extreme trial. And yet, in Genesis 50:20, what does it say? "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." God meant for them selling Joseph into slavery for good. That same truth is pulled from Romans. Romans 8:37 says, "No, in all things we know we are more than conquerors through him who loved us." What does that mean? Well, what's a conqueror? A conqueror is someone that comes in and completely just obliterates something, destroys it. So is this saying that we are conquerors through him who loved us? That means that God is doing something more than just destroying the trials we go through. To be more than a conqueror is to take that bad thing and to flip it around into something good and to do something good with it. Romans tells us that the trials that we go through, the trials we experience, that God is using those for good. For good. And the third thing I think that we could take away is that God is faithful through it all. God is faithful through it all. Hebrews 10:23 says, "Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful." What does it mean to be faithful? Stephen, in an article for the Gospel Coalition, says, "God's faithfulness is his attribute that displays his trustworthiness based on his unwavering commitment to his people through his promises and covenants that find their ultimate fulfillment in the person of Jesus Christ." Something that we need to remember about the fact that we've been saved is that we didn't do it. We're saved by the grace of God. God intervenes in our life and saves us. God gets all the glory for our salvation. We get none of the glory for our salvation. Romans 8:35 says, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword?" Who can separate anything from Christ that Christ does not want separated? God's holding on to us. And he will not let go of us. Our salvation is secure. Our hope is secure. Because it's not based on us. It's based on him. John 10:27 through 30 says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." If you've placed your faith in Jesus Christ, a greater day is coming. Because he has saved you, and he's holding on to you, and he'll never let you go. He's faithful to complete what he started in you. He's faithful to carry you all the way to the end and to glorify you. As we look back on 2020, I think we can all agree that it's been a hard year. I think it's okay for us to look forward to a new year. It's okay for us to be excited about the end of the pandemic. It's okay for us to have hope that a cure can be found, that vaccines will help bring this pandemic to an end. It's okay to hope that things will be better, that you'll find a job, that the suffering that you're experiencing will be momentary and come to an end. That's okay. But as Christians, our ultimate hope is so much better than the end of a pandemic. Our ultimate hope is so much better than getting a job and getting out of poverty. Our ultimate hope is so much better than living a healthy, wealthy life on this earth. And that hope that we have is found in the gospel. A day is coming where there will be no more sickness, no more pandemics. There will be no more tears. And on that day, when our Savior, Jesus Christ, returns, we'll know what true joy really is. We have the gift of eternal life with our God and Savior. He has promised to glorify us, and He is faithful to do that. Romans 8, 38, 39. God is faithful. Because of that, I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Thank you for loving us, for showing mercy to us, for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to this world. In spite of the fact that we rebel against you, you have shown mercy to us. You've shown grace to us to place faith in him as our Savior. God, thank you that he is alive, that he's defeated death, that he's defeated sin. God, that you've reconciled us. God, and that you will glorify us. God, I pray that you would give us the grace to know that that's true. And to know that no matter what trials we go through, no matter how hard this life may seem, it's momentary. It's just a mist, a breath. This momentary life is nothing compared to an eternity with you. And we are promised that thanks to you and what you have accomplished. Thank you, God. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
I invite you again to stand up.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter will prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often called. Door.
Good evening. I'm Ray, one of the elders of New Life Church. Actually, I was a member of ECC, and then we planted New Life Church. Please pray with me. I'm praying for supplication, prayer of supplication for 2021. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we praise you, we honor you, we worship you. We know, Lord, that you are the one and only true God. You are all-knowing, all-seeing, and almighty. Nothing is impossible with you, Father. You are sovereign over all. And we know, Lord, that you are a good, good Father. But, Lord, we know that we are sinners. We fall short of your glory. We ask, Lord, for your forgiveness again, Lord, before I pray. Any further, Lord, I want to confess my sin. Forgive me, Lord, for everything that I've done that did not bring glory to your name. Forgive me, Father. Let me not be a hindrance to this prayer, Lord. Please forgive me. Heavenly Father, thank you also for all the blessings that we continue to receive from you. We know that all good things come from you, Father, and we will always be thankful. Heavenly Father, we know that you love us. We know that you are sovereign. We know that you are in control of everything, Lord. So, Lord, we just need to trust in you. We know that all things come for a reason, and everything is for your glory. So, Heavenly Father, we know that you will do your part because you are faithful. You are faithful forever. Heavenly Father, I ask that you help us to do our part. I pray, Father, for spiritual growth for everybody. I pray, Lord, for increased faith, faith that can move mountains. I pray, Father, that you would continue to give us your wisdom, guide us in every decision that we make. For we know that you alone can see the whole picture. You can see the future. And we just need to trust in you, Lord. I pray, Father, that we would continue to work out our salvation with fear and trembling as you work in us to will and to act according to your good pleasure. I pray, Father, that we would be doers of your word, not just hearers. I pray for strength, conviction, and power from the Holy Spirit to help us to be bold, to share, and to be able to clearly explain the gospel to our circle of influence, to our family, to our friends, and to our work colleagues. I pray, Father, that we continue to share the love of Jesus to others. I pray that we would love Jesus more and more and hate our sins even greater. I pray, Father, that in everything that we meditate on, everything that we say and do would bring glory to your name, Lord. I pray, Lord, that as a church, not only the local church, but the universal church, would strive hard to be one with Jesus and to strive hard to encourage and support one another as spiritual brothers and sisters, that we would not give too much attention to our inherent differences, being coming from different cultures, different countries, but focus more on our common love for you, Jesus. May we continue to grow in our love for one another as we grow in love with you, for you. Lord, indeed, may we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May everything that we say and do bring you honor, bring you glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I'll be closing with our doxology from Ephesians chapter 3 tonight. I hope that you were encouraged. Thank you, Cares, for the word that you preached to us. He indeed is faithful and able to keep us until the very end, and we look forward to that day. Thank you to ECC for your encouragement over this festive season. Thank you for joining with us as New Life Church and encouraging us and fellowshipping with us and praising the Lord with us. It's been wonderful to do that, and we look forward to doing it again next year, again, hopefully, with you. Hopefully not with these conditions, but hopefully in a better festive season as well. To those of you who've joined us online, thank you for joining us. And if you would like to reach out to any of us, the website for New Life Church is www.newlifechurch.ae, and the website for ECC, www.eccad.org. Did I get that right? Excellent. We hope that you would reach out to us if you have any questions, or if we can share or speak with you or counsel you anything about the gospel that you heard tonight. It would be our privilege and our pleasure to do that. So from Ephesians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 17. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, and that you be filled with hope and with all the fullness of God. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us. I hope that you have a wonderful new year, and may the Lord be honored and glorified in our lives this year. Thank you for joining us. God bless you. Am I going to let people out?